Hi everyone, I'm Camilla Del Rio. I'm a data scientist in the analytics team of the IT consulting company Moviri, that is based in Milan, Italy. First, I would like to thank you for today to give me the opportunity to be a presenter at the NOS 2021 Summit. It's really an honor for me. For the next half an hour, I will walk you through the solution that we have, the graph-based solution that we have built for and with our customers. And all these have been wrapped up under the fanciful name Set Your Graph in Hyperdrive with Machine Learning and MLOps. So, without further ado, let's start having a look at the agenda. So, we will start by giving a little bit of context, mentioning some of the main needs of our customers, also explaining which are the challenges that we have faced and are actually still facing during the creation of this kind of graph-based platform. Then we will see why Neo4j was our go-to solution to solve and to address the customer needs, and how actually the graph, Neo4j graph, is at the core of a much wider analytics platform that is automated, scalable, and maintained following the MLOps principle. Last but not least, we will see a couple of use cases, additional use cases with respect to the one that we have presented during the that we have presented during the speech to close up the entire presentation. So let's start with a little bit of context. Among the many needs of our customer, we have identified three of them, which are, in our opinion, the most important and also the most frequent. The very first one is actually the need to map all the IT system, but from different point of views. So starting from the bare metal up to the business processes, and also mapping the customer of the applications themselves. So the second aim that we have reported here, the second need actually, is the anomaly detection. This is quite a hot topic during the last few years. We have heard a lot talking about this, and it can be applied to many different fields. So in our case, we implemented algorithms to detect the faulty parts to perform actions in the incident mitigation and prevention area. But also, we helped our customer in identifying all the uncompliant access grants that are in the typical that are typical of the identity and access management world. The third need that we reported here is the scenario simulation. So we built a strong platform that enables not just to monitor what's happening in your system, but also helps you in understanding what could happen on your system, actually, making a scenario simulation. So if you think about the incident mitigation part, it could be really useful to understand which are the main impacted configuration items or the sectors or the functional areas of your graph by a typical kind of incident. In a more practical way, you would like also to understand which would be the impact for a change in the configurations. So this might seem quite easy to do, but actually it is not. So we have reported here just a couple of challenges that we have identifying during the construction of our of this environment with our customers. So first of all, the complexity of the operations. The complexity not only in the construction of the platform, but also the complexity brought by the data itself. So in order to tame this complexity, we used science, network science, of course, but also the usual data science algorithm. Let me call them typical data science algorithms. The second main challenge is the centralization. So the platform needs to be really flexible, scalable, and able to grow with the different kind of data that may be integrated inside the system itself. Third, that is maybe the really hardest one, is the literacy. So whenever you bring a new tool, a new technology inside a well working environment with the team that is used to work with other tools, it is really important to make them understand which are the potential of this new technology and which are the use cases that can be enabled, and which are the actually the actions and the, for example, everyday jobs that it can ease up. So in our case, our go-to solution was Neo4j, but why? So we were asked to map data that spans from the bare metals of the racks that contain the data centers, the racks of data centers, up to the business processes, passing through the network information and the risk measures, the customer mapping, and also the identity and access management. So the kind of data that we needed to integrate together was really wide, really different. So I always think about the joining of the different tables containing all these different informations coming from different functional areas. So I used to laugh because I think about them like the cards as the last screen when you win the solitaire in Windows 95. There are all these cards that just keep flowing down, and you can stop them. But in our case, those cards would be the tables. So you just have to work with 1,000 tables reporting different information, and you need to match them up. So why still using typical tools and not use a proper tool like the graph to retrieve fast information and to also discover new insights that you may miss in using the other system. So in this framework, Neo4j was our go-to solution because it was providing us this kind of flexibility, the speed in retrieving information, and also the possibility to build networks of networks. So if you think about the identity and access management, actually you can map them as a graph per se, but of course they are strictly linked to the IT system because they're granting accesses to specific applications. So what we needed to do was to join this world together and then of course apply science on it. And for that, actually, we exploited the very powerful GDS library and the Graph Data Science library. So let's take it step by step. So the very first step in doing this in building the solution and in taming the complexity is building a clear and safe and sound ontology. So you need to tie up your workspace and have a clear map of all the system so that you can retrieve information and understand which are the cores or the nodes that are the cores of your platform, and also to understand which are actually all the information that you can map. At the same time, the ontology needs to be really flexible because, of course, as we mentioned before, we need to centralize many different kinds of information. So you need also to always to build an ontology that's strong. So this is not a really straightforward job because actually you needed to translate what you have always seen inside the relational database or inside the time series database or in mapped in logs, for example. You need to translate all this information in a graph-friendly format. Once you have managed to do so, you need to transpose the ontology inside the graph, and then the fun begins because you can apply also algorithm of graph data science and find out all those hidden insights that are proper of the relationship between the components. So now you're mapping the components as nodes and the relationships and as edges. Now the graph science algorithm can help you in understanding which are actually the insight based on the graph structure. So we're talking about graph science, and let's see together what we actually put in place from the Graph Data Science library. So we have just reported three examples of use cases. The first one is the analysis of the impact and propagation of the incident. So we didn't want to rely just on the relationships that were mapped on the ontology, but also we wanted to understand which were the most interconnected parts of the graph in order to understand which could be the parts, the components that could be affected by an incident or by a change to a specific configuration item or a specific application, and how it can spread the impact on the on its neighborhood. So we exploited the community detection algorithm, in particular Luven, to identify this part of the graph and to understand its topology. The second use case is related to the high impact application for incident mitigation. So we identified those applications that were more important and that could have a broader impact if an incident would affect them. So we exploited the centrality algorithm along with the other algorithm that we will see also in a couple of slides. So we computed the centrality of these applications through the PageRank algorithms in order to understand which were actually the hot spot of our graph and which were actually the applications on which someone needs to focus. These would help in triggering actions such as incident prioritization, reprioritization, and also the trigger of specific analysis for the investigation of the condition of the application itself. The third algorithms is related to the necessity to extract the information from the graph and make it usable inside the algorithms that are that belongs to different data science fields. So, for example, we needed to translate the node format into a vector format in order to apply algorithm of prediction and clustering. In this case, we exploited the FastRP, actually the FastRP extended algorithm for node embedding in order to extract the information and to apply other algorithms on top of that. So, we are talking about the GraphDB, the graph data science, that are actually at the core, but of a much wider structure. So here I've reported just a really simple schema, let me say, but that is hiding the real complexity of the construction of such a complicated platform. So let's start from the beginning. So everything starts with data. So the platform is able to integrate both batch and streaming data sources. And the ingestion layer is in charge of performing different kinds of tasks. So both the tasks that are related to the typical ATL flow, so the extract, transform, and load, okay, fine, but also the data cleaning. But the most important role that the data ingestion layer has is related to the work of the translation of data inside in a graph usable format. So once the data have been transformed according following of course the design of your ontology, you can load this data inside Neo4j, and that's where the fun part begins. So the MLOps procedure is in charge of monitoring the data analysis pipeline. The data analysis pipeline are based both on network science algorithm and machine learning algorithm. So basically, what we did for the development of the use cases is run the network science algorithm exploiting the graph.science library on Neo4j. The outputs of this analysis were taken by the analytics layer to run machine learning algorithms on top where needed, and the results were written back inside Neo4j, and the outcome of the use cases were made available to the final stakeholders through the visualization layer. So talking about modeling, so we built one of the a big environment to perform data science, to implement data science. So the aim of the platform itself is, of course, to combine the results of the network science and machine learning models. So here we are just giving to you just a couple of examples of models that we have actually implemented in the analytics layer. So we have talked about the incident prediction and mitigation, and we have talked about, if you remember, the centrality index. So we in this part, we combined the information of the time series analysis. So we took the time series analysis of incidents. We performed the exponential moving average algorithm to smooth the time series, and then we applied the support vector regression to predict the number of incidents for the next time span of interest. If the prediction is higher than a tuned threshold, then we can identify those CI, those applications also, that needs to be monitored. Then the other algorithm that we are presenting to you right now is related to the graph embedding. So if you remember, we use the FastRP in order to translate nodes in a format that would be friendly for the application of data science algorithms for prediction and clustering. Now we are presenting the clustering part. So we made this analysis in order to understand if we were somehow missing something with the community detection. So we wanted to understand which were the clusters inside our network in order to have first a comparison between the two results and also to have a composition, an algorithm that could help in identifying the correct results for the proper use case and according to the data that our customer has. So for the clustering part, we applied the k-means algorithms. We have also tested the k-median algorithm for clustering, and all this is really a part of developing solutions that are really linked to the needs of our customer and also to be assessed with backtesting. So we have seen the platform before, the construction of the platform itself. So everything is actually managed following the MLOps principle. So the MLOps principle combine the DevOps principle with the ML part. So we don't just have the CI/CD part, but we have also the CT, so the continuous training of the model. I'm sorry for the lovers of MLOps if this schema is too simple, but I really just want to give a grasp of the idea behind MLOps. So everything again starts with that, with data. The very first part on which we need to work is the ML model pipeline in the analytics layer. So this is the fun part for the data scientists. It's where the models are born and where all the hyperparameter tuning and all the analysis on the classes and all the different tests are performed. Once the model is stable and reaches a right level of precision or a fine level of readiness to be put in production, then it is actually put in production. So it becomes part of the production pipeline that is working and managed through the monitoring engine. So the core of all this is actually the monitoring engine that is triggered both either on a scheduled basis or when new data and features are collected. The role of this monitoring engine is really important because it tests the unbalance, whether there are unbalanced classes or whether there are new schema inside the data, or if there are a decrease in the performance of the model itself. So if everything goes fine, then the production pipeline is run and all the results are written inside the model registry, and we take care of recording also the ML metadata part. If the model has a decay in the performance, then the data scientist is warned, and a new flow starting from the ML model development starts. So again, try new models or fix the models that are already in pipeline, in the production pipeline, and then put them again in production. There are a lot of tools that allow you to perform this kind of operations, but actually in Moviri, we have created our own MLOps framework. Just to really give you a hint of what it's made of, this framework is based on three different processes. The first one is the ATL process that is directly connected to Neo4j, so it gets data. It performs some checks on the concept drift and on the schema changes. Then data are then transferred to the ML process that is in charge of running the model and testing the performance of the model itself. And if everything goes fine, then the SERP process is in charge of writing back the updated outcome of the analysis inside Neo4j. And also, of course, taking care of all the part of the model registry, of feeding the model registry and the ML metadata store. Well, we have reached the final configuration of our platform. The graph core of the analytics platform, and then we have described all the parts related to the analytics, MLOps, data ingestion, of course, and the final part of the visualization. We focused on the graph part and the analytics part because our the MLOps part because are the one most important in our opinion. So. The main question is, okay, I have this really super powerful platform. What should I do with it? So during the presentation, we mentioned a couple of times the incident prevention, incident mitigation, and incident prediction part. With the same ontology, we can actually perform a root cause analysis in order to understand which was the actual trigger of some specific incidents. And by enlarging this ontology, because we are actually mapping information about customer, we can also perform some actions that are strictly related for now to the CRM. So we can also perform community detection algorithm, customer segmentation to identify who are the best target for our new campaign, for example. So. I would like to finish up this presentation giving a big up also to the entire Moviri Analytics team because today I'm the only one speaking, but actually all this effort is made by an entire team of really skilled data scientists, and I would really like to thank Benedetta, Alessandro, Luigi, Rashid, and Dario, which helped in the construction of all this. So actually, this is it from my side. So let's turn it back to the host. Thank you.